Now we are very excited to welcome Mattress Mack, and we have a little gift for you from our community. And I just wanted to show you a couple things we've got in the basket because they're pretty cool. This piece of quartz right here is from Hendrix, so it was made right here in Sealy, and it was engraved by Glenn's Engraving, a few of our members.
Very nice, thank you. Very nice.
Yeah. Also in here, we have a knife that was handmade at Phoenix Knives. So if you guys have never been there, you've got to go check them out in Belleville, and you can actually hand forge your own knife. And they've got a really cool event coming up the first weekend of April where they actually have forgers come from, it's called Texas Select, and they have forgers from all over the nation come out for that. It's pretty cool.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I love the knife.
So a couple other little things that we've got in here is we've got a nice container here from Citizen State Bank. We've got a nice mug from Austin County State Bank. We of course have some cheese head things from Larry Kachemba over at Paramount Promotions, because he's an owner, if you didn't know, of the cheese heads.
Green Bay Packers.
Thank you.
A couple bottles of wine from our winery.
Thank you very much. They're very nice. Thank you.
So I've got you right here.
I'm ready to go.
We are so excited to have you out today, and we appreciate how much you do for our community here in Sealy and Houston and everywhere else. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Chelsea. Thanks, Chelsea, and everybody for having me here at the Sealy Chamber of Commerce. I'm excited to be here. Can you hear me in the back? Good. I got a big voice anyway. Big voice, big mouth. I am honored and thrilled to be here today. And I love the title of the Lunch and Lunch and Learn. Hopefully, through a couple of points I make, you can learn something to help your business. I really want to congratulate Bott's title, being in business 141 years. Citizen State Bank, 117 years. In this day and age, that is just incredible. Let's give them a big round of applause. I've only been at it 42 years, so I got 99 more years to catch up with Bott's. Hope I live that long. However, before I launch into this semi-brilliant dissertation, let me give you some of my less than illustrious backgrounds. I hope you know where I'm not headed to. You see, I was doing real well about 44 short years ago. I was 28 years old, living at home with my folks in Dallas where I grew up at, and I had kind of a menial job. I was sacking groceries, making about $3 an hour. And there's nothing wrong with sacking groceries, nothing wrong with making minimum wage, but I kind of felt like with my college education, my background, that maybe I should be doing something a little better than that. Anyway, I had a bad attitude. And the name of that convenience store where I was working, that was located in a rough neighborhood there in Northeast Dallas, the name of that convenience store, it was called a Stop and Rob. And one day the boss walked in, looked up at me, he said, you got a bad attitude. And I said, yes, sir, I know it, sir, but I'm trying to change. He said, son, I got news for you. So the thoughts raced in my mind, what's the news? A raise, a promotion, what's he going to do for me? I said, that's great, what are you going to do for me? He said, boy, you're fired. I said, oh no, I went home that night to my folks' house in Dallas. And I went into a depression for several weeks. I felt sorry for myself. I felt like I was a victim of circumstances. Like, unfortunately, millions of Americans nowadays, I felt like I was entitled to a nice home, nice car, nice job without having to work for it. So I went into a deep depression for about 6 or 8 weeks. Woke up kind of early one Sunday morning, several weeks later, stumbled in on the television where the television was. I turned the television on, and there was a religious program on this Sunday morning. I really wasn't looking for any religion at the television, but the preacher was preaching a message, so I decided I'd watch for a while. I turned the television on, and the preacher said, you know, there's a lot of you out there in television land today that are throwing your lives away. He said, you're wallowing in the throes of self-pity. He said, you feel sorry for yourself. You feel like the world owes you a favor. He said, let me tell you something. The world doesn't owe you a favor. You owe the world a favor. He said, get up, go to work, and make something out of your life. And that was an absolutely seminal event in my life. I remember it like it was yesterday, even though it was 44 years ago. He said, get up, go to work, and make something out of your life. And that really kind of shook me to my core. So the next day I got up and I, within a couple of days, I found a job at a small furniture store. And the problem was that furniture store was located about 60 miles from my parents' house and I had no car. So I learned that in business and in life, you do what you have to do. You don't pay the price, you enjoy the price. So I rode the bus 2 hours out there every morning and 2 hours back at night. But I found something I was good at. I was good at retailing. And after about 18 months, I began to dream maybe have my own furniture store. However, I didn't want to open a furniture store up there in Dallas to compete with my boss who taught me the business. So I asked him in late 1980 where it'd be a good place to start a furniture store somewhere in Texas other than Dallas. He said, "Kid, I understand Houston's a boom town. Try Houston." At that time, my beloved brother George, who I played football with at the University of Texas many years ago, was a real estate agent in Houston. I told him what I was trying to do. He called me back about a week later and he said, "I got your location." So I was all excited about this entrepreneurial project we were going to do. So I went out to dinner that night with my little girlfriend. Her name was Linda. She'd been with me through all my ups and downs and many problems and failures in life. She got in the car that night. I said, "Linda, I got great news for you tonight." She said, "What's that, Mac?" I said, "We're going to move to Houston. We're going to get in the furniture business." She said, "There ain't no way." I said, "Linda, you understand? So we're going to move to Houston to get in the furniture business. We just might do well. We might make some money." She said, "Look, Mac, you don't understand something." I said, "What's that?" She said, "All my friends are here in Dallas, went to school here. I've got a good job. I'm not moving to Houston. I'm not getting the furniture business with you." Well, I learned if you're going to be successful in business and life, above all, you have to be persistent. Never give up. So I kept asking her that night and asking and asking her. Finally, about 11 o'clock, asked her about the 40 times. She got very frustrated with me. She slammed her hand on the dashboard and said, "I'll tell you what, Mac." She said, "I'll move to Houston. I'll get the furniture business with you. But you're going to have to marry me first." And I got to thinking to myself, this woman has put me on a difficult decision. But then I came up with what I consider to be an entrepreneurial brainstorm. I thought to myself, where else can I get an employee this cheap? I said, "You got a deal." So we moved to Houston in 1981. I've given this speech 1,000 times. And some reason she was with me a couple of months ago. I was doing this speech. And I always told the story we had $5,000 in a dream. Well, she corrected me. We had $3,600 in a dream. And, you know, all of her friends, neighbors, relatives, they said we'd never make it. They said we're undercapitalized, which was terribly true. They said I didn't have any contacts in the furniture business in Houston, which was true. They said that I didn't know about anything about running a furniture store, which was true. And so the odds of us succeeding probably were about 1,000,000 to 1. But, you know, I had a great big unfair advantage. And the same advantage everybody here at the Sealy Chamber of Commerce Luncheon Luncheon has. That great big unfair advantage I had was called desire. I believed then in 1981, I believe now in 2023, you can do anything you want to do in this country if you want to do it bad enough. These kids ask me all the time, "What's your best advice you can give me?" Find a job you love to do and you never have to work a day in your life. And so me and that little girl started that business, and the first 9 months we slept at the furniture store, couldn't afford to have anybody steal our inventory. Not at all unusual for us to sell out of furniture on Saturday night. We had a U-Haul truck and I'd drive that truck Saturday night at 9 o'clock after we closed to Dallas, my friend's store, and take our receipts from that day and buy furniture from him and drive it back to Houston and sell it on Sunday. So here we are, still in business 42 years later. That's why it's such a tribute, 141 years and 117 years to bots and citizens. It's amazing. Lessons learned. Number one. The genius in life is sticking to it. Thomas Edison. Unfortunately, we live in a disposable world. And if something doesn't work, we give it up. When the water gets hot, we jump out. True for all sorts of things. The genius in life is sticking to it. That's what Thomas Edison said. He tried the light bulb 10,000 times, failed 10,000 times. 10,001, he changed the world. Number two. Don't tell me or you it's impossible until after we've already done it. Every entrepreneur in this building knows that every naysayer said you would never make it. And every third base coach said that's already been tried before. That's too difficult or this or that. Don't tell me it's impossible until after I've already done it. Number three. This is a quote from Henry Aaron, home run king. I went to watch the Astros play Atlanta in the World Series a couple years ago, and there's a big statue of him in the lobby. It says, his quote, "No matter how deep a slump I was in, no matter how many problems I had off the field, the one thing I never did was I didn't quit swinging. I always kept swinging. Stay in the game. You're going to have lots of setbacks. They're going to knock you down 10,000 times. You got to get up 10,500 times and you win. Every day there's going to be a new obstacle in front of you." Henry Aaron kept swinging and he got there. Mark Twain, one of my favorite authors, he said, 95% of life is showing up. He said, 95% of life is showing up. I show up all the time. And it's incredible what I learned from those customers and this team members, employees. I was out there Sunday night a couple months ago complaining to myself about how business really slowed down since the interest rates went way up and furniture's tied at the hip to housing. So I'm wandering around and I see these two ladies and I ask them, "Are they doing okay?" Yeah, they said, "We're fine." Then it was a mom and daughter. The mom said to me, she said, "Can I ask you a question?" I said, "Sure." She said, "It's Sunday night. We're in the Great Gallery Furniture Store and there's nobody here." She said, "Where's all the customers?" And you know what? That was a question I really didn't want to hear, but I needed to hear it. So I sat down and asked them what they did, and they're in the phone room business at car dealerships, and they gave me some hints and tips that changed my marketing trajectory forever just because I was there at 7:30 on Sunday night. Where are the customers? Next. The best ability is availability. I'm available to those customers every day. Every customer that bought furniture yesterday, I call them the next day. I want to know how their delivery went. It enables me to keep a pulse on how well the delivery drivers are doing, how well the entire business is doing. Stay in touch with those customers. You know, a lot of us are being inundated by high tech. High tech's a wonderful product, so is high touch. Amazon doesn't call people back. Amazon doesn't have relationships. You got to find a way to succeed. Next, nobody said free enterprise and being an entrepreneur was going to be fun, easy, or fair. Nobody says it's going to be fun, easy, or fair. They're going to knock you down, you got to get back up. They're going to knock you down, you got to get back up. You know, it was very unfortunate that the University of Texas football team lost the other night. But you know what? They got to go back home, put their big boy britches on, and go back at it again. That's the way life is. Nobody says it's going to be fun, easy, or fair. And if you're prepared for that, when the setbacks come your way, you just work your way through them because life's all about getting knocked down and getting back up. I saw a slogan on a wall one day. I adopted it. It said, "Life offers you a second chance." It said, "Life offers you a second chance. It's called tomorrow. Suit up." It's pretty good, isn't it? Innovate or evaporate. You know, the problem with me is I've been tremendously successful over 42 years. And the problem is we come calcified. And that saying, "This is the way we've always done it," dominates our conversation. The biggest success to future success is your past success. Because we live in an ever-changing world, don't we? You know, I grew up, television was a big thing. Now these kids get all their information from that cell phone. and they watch football games with cell phones. Totally different world. So you got to innovate or evaporate. You got to take on those new things and try them. And about 90% of them will fail, but the 10% that succeed will get you there. Interesting how I saw a news flash that U.S. Steel was just sold to Nippon Steel, a Japanese company, a month or so ago. For decades, U.S. Steel was the biggest company in the country. The biggest company in the country, but they didn't innovate. A lot of you people in here that are my age grew up at Sears and Roebuck, the world's greatest retailer. They owned retail for 100 years. Now they're all gone. We all have to embrace innovation. Next. The American dream is still as viable for all you young people in here as it was for people my age or is for people my age. People ask me all the time, could you start Galvey Furniture today in a New York minute? All you got to do is get up earlier, stay late, and innovate. Get up early, stay late, and innovate. People say the American dream is over. I totally disagree with that. The American dream is about having a dream, finding a job you love to do, and you'll never have to work a day in your life. Can't wait to get to work in the morning. Can't wait to take care of those customers. Next, the customer is the business. The business is the customer. Some of y'all have been at the entrepreneur serving customers for a year. Some have been serving customers 5 years. Some for 10, some for 20, maybe some for 50. Here's a haunting question. Remember the first customer you ever had? You remember the first sale you ever had or the first customer you ever served? Remember how eager you were to take care of that customer and to make sure everything went right with their order and make sure everything was just perfect? Because that was a big deal to you. Now, 5, 10, 15, 20 years later, are you just as excited about serving that customer every day, or is it just another transaction to you? To that customer, it's a big deal. The customer is the business, business is the customer. And last but not least, work is life's greatest therapy. I have a lot of anecdotal knowledge. My anecdotal knowledge comes from being in the front of that store 42 years. People ask me all the time, they come up there on Sunday night and they see me there, they say, when are you going to retire? I said, I'm going to die right here at the front desk and I'll die happy. You know, over the last 42 years, I've given away millions of dollars to people. And I've helped a lot of people. But finally, I saw the same people coming back all the time. And I figured out to myself, this ain't working. And I have a little daughter, her name's Elizabeth. She has a severe mental illness, she'll always have it, called obsessive compulsive disorder. She was told by all the psychiatrists we took her to in Houston when she was in the fifth or sixth grade that we should put her in an institution for the rest of her life. But somehow the wonderful teachers at her high school, Westfield High School, public high school in Houston, helped her get through high school. And then she fought that mental illness for years, went in and out of hospitals. Then she decided she wanted to help people with the same illness she had and ended up getting a PhD from U of H. And now she's one of the premier OCD clinicians in the world. But she'll rightfully tell you that work saved her life. Working with her patients saved her life. My friend Temple Grandin is the world's premier expert on animal husbandry. She's fully autistic. Never talked till she was 5 years old. I was up at her birthday party at Colorado State University, and big building there was dedicated to her. And she put on the front of the building, "Working with animals saved my life, Temple Grandin." She was in seventh grade. Her mother sent her away to a boarding school, and they put her in charge of mucking out the horse stalls, and she found something she loved to do, and it changed her life. So the anecdotal knowledge I have learned is that all of us need to get more Americans to work. All of us need to get more Americans to work. I got three guys up there working for me right now that they said that job saved their life in the last year. and hundreds of other ones have been through there. What we need is work. We don't need more welfare. We don't need more government handouts. We need to find people a job they love to do, because work brings purpose and meaning to life. Work brings purpose and meaning to life. So it's incumbent upon all of us entrepreneurs here to grow our business. To go to bed at night thinking about how we're going to grow the business, wake up in the morning thinking about how we're going to grow the business, and think about how we can employ more American workers. I was at Texas A&M about a month ago, speaking to the business school honor students, a great group of young people, about 100. So I got up there and I talked about buy American products, support American jobs. And I talked about my history in the furniture business. It used to be I'd go to North Carolina and you'd go through these factory towns where these giant furniture factories were, like Broyhill or Henry Don, all of them. And that factory would employ thousands of American workers. And because that factory employed thousands of American workers, there was a huge infrastructure around the factory of schools and restaurants and car dealerships that supported the workers that worked in those factories, those good-paying jobs. Well, then some genius MBA decided they could make the furniture cheaper if they made it in China or Vietnam or wherever, Thailand. And they moved the factory out. And the town dried up. And you know what happened? An oxycodone epidemic. Because their life had no purpose, no meaning anymore. They had no job. And fast forward 20 years, now it's fentanyl. What are we doing to ourselves? When did this country decide to denigrate work? What's wrong with starting at the bottom and working your way up because you're ambitious? So I give a speech to these kids at Texas A&M. One of the bright students asked me, he said, you know, it's a global economy. He said, I don't see anything wrong with buying products from overseas, blah, blah, blah. What difference does it make? I said, you know, I've been coming to College Station making speeches over here in College Station Bryan for 30 years. I said, and every time I come here, there's more buildings, more restaurants, more stuff going on, high rises, housing developments. It's boomtown. He said, yeah, it sure is. I said, what would happen to Bryan College Station if you took Texas A&M out? He got the point. Our job is to provide jobs for Americans. Because people that have a job have purpose and meaning in their life. My final story about my friend Devon Strait. She started Briarwood, a school for children with severe mental challenges, 60 years ago, and now Brookwood out here in Brookshire, Texas. Brookwood, they have 99 full-time citizens. They don't call them residents. They don't call them patients. They are citizens. And they treat them that way. And every citizen at Brookwood has mental handicaps. Some have Down syndrome. Some got in a severe car or motorcycle accident, had brain damage. Everybody's got a problem. But every citizen at Brookwood has a full-time job, even a paraplegics. Because Yvonne has learned over the years that work brings purpose and meaning to life. So he had this big-time business executive who got in a severe motorcycle accident, brain damage, and they brought him to Brookwood. And the jobs they do are kind of simple and repetitive, and this guy refused to do any of those jobs. Finally, after 4 or 5 months, they found a job he liked to do and he got good at it. So one day, a Friday afternoon, Yvonne was sitting in her office and she's about ready to go home. It's 4 or 5 o'clock. She sees this guy running down the hallway with a piece of paper in his hand. And he's sprinting full speed, and Yvonne's very startled by all this. And the guy burst in her office holding this piece of paper in his hand. She said, John, what in the world is the problem? What's the matter? He said, Miss Strait, look what I got. She said, John, what'd you get? He said, I got a paycheck. He said, I am a real person now. That's our job. Hire more Americans. Hire more Americans. Give people purpose and meaning in their life. Thanks very much.
Did you have time for a couple questions?
Sure.
Well, it means so much that you're here today. And we do have a couple minutes if we have any questions out there. Anybody have any questions?
Any questions? I'm not shy. Oh, I forgot to tell y'all, if y'all need any furniture, we still deliver to Sealy tonight.
They'll call us tomorrow.
That's right.
I can't believe this, but I think you left them speechless. It means...
Oh, yes, ma'am.
I do have something just to want to say. My husband was injured in the line of duty, and I gave you a call that same day. And
we had furniture delivered
that
out
that night. So you
have
affected us tremendously.
And
you still
called
the next day to see
how
the delivery went.
Thank you, ma'am. God bless you.
Mine's not a question, but when I was in high school, I saw you on the side of the road selling mattresses out of a truck. I've watched you your whole career, and it is cool to see what he has done. He means it, because he lived it. Like, I've watched
you. I'm still showing up every day. Yes, sir.
Judge Laughing.
Mac, you give opportunities to a lot of people to have jobs that a lot of businesses won't hire. And sometimes that's a person that's maybe not as dependable, maybe not, doesn't have your history. Tell us about that. Tell us, how do you manage those people to put them in the best position that they have? Because it's hard when they go around. I put a listing up once a week for positions, and I get people call all the time, this company won't hire me, this company won't hire me. And I understand that. I understand, because you're putting your trust, your business in those hands. You're there on the floor. I've seen you. You know, you're involved in it. And some places can't always have that. But how do you manage that? And, you know, thank you for the opportunity, because I've heard some stories here today of people that you've offered jobs to. Tell us how you manage that.
You know, we hire people with history. We hire some felons. And the best thing I've ever done, you know, here's an amazing statistic. This used to be an agrarian country. And people in an agrarian economy knew their neighbors because they never moved. In 1900, the average size of the U.S. household was 10.5 people. 10.5. So you had brothers and sisters and aunts and uncles and all these people taking care of you and looking after you. The average size of the U.S. household today, less than 2. 1's the loneliest number. So those kids come to me and their eyes are darting everywhere. They're scared to death. They don't know what to do. They haven't been taught any life skills, any people skills. The biggest thing schools ought to teach is people skills. And so we bring them in and we try to calm them down. But the best thing we've ever done is we feed them lunch, dinner, and a snack every day in our little restaurant. And the rule is, you can't be on your cell phone, you can't be on your iPad in that restaurant. You got to sit there and actually talk to the guy or the girl next to you. Imagine that. And pretty soon, they're scared to death. Pretty soon, they know 3 or 4 people there that they work with. And pretty soon, they have friends there. Then all of a sudden, when their car breaks down, they find a way to show up to work because they don't want to disappoint their friend. And when they have a problem, somebody at the table has had that problem before and can help them solve it. And they learn financial literacy and all those type of things. So the best thing we've ever done is given those place, creating a sense of community. You know, it used to be, and it still should be, that people had a job, they had an extended family, and they went to church. Unfortunately, a lot of people don't do any of those 3 things anymore, and it's destroyed the society. So we need to go back to those basic fundamental things. Human beings were made to live, work, play, and die in groups. And so when they are welcomed by their friends, and then all of a sudden they start moving up, and they think, you know, I started here with nothing, now I got a car, and then I got an apartment, and then I got a house 5 years later. They see the American dream works for them, too. So it's constant repetition. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. If you had to give 5 tips for financial literacy to build a long-term foundation for a startup business, what are the 5 tips that you'd give?
Keep the overhead low. Find something you love to do where it's not a burden, because there'll be a lot of weeks and months you can't pay yourself. Never give up. Always be innovating. Innovate or evaporate. And lastly, you got to believe in yourself, and you got to work your ass off. I got a note from the athletic director of the University of Texas the other day. He said, "Sorry we didn't win, but you can be sure of one thing. We're going to work our ass off trying to get back there." Great crowd. Thanks for having me here. Remember, we can still deliver your furniture tonight. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks, thank you so much to everybody that you're here.